Paola Pino, es arquitecta, es filósofa y doctora en arquitectura, es profesora de teoría urbana y de diseño urbano por la Escuela Politécnica de Los Andes, donde ella además dirige el laboratorio de urbanismo LabVIEW en la Universidad de UAPTBS. Ha sido profesora invitada en muchas escuelas europeas en el 2012-2013 y incluida en Graduate School of Design de Harvard. Y Thomas Jefferson, profesor en la Universidad de Virginia. En 2013, Paola Pino fue la primera mujer, esto es importante, que recibió el Gran Premio Urbanismo Clase. En 2016, fue premiada con el título de doctor honoris causa por la Universidad Católica de Roma. En 2017, Paola Pino recibió el premio Flemings de la Cultura por Arquitectura Última Architecture. Desde 1990 hasta 2014, junto a Bernardo Secchi, fundó la oficina Estudio, realizando el Parque Spormor, el Teatro Plein en Amberes y la City Structural Plan de Amberes, el Parque Espacios Públicos de Michelin y el Cementerio de Portrait, el Master Plan y Público de Espacios de la CUS en Rennes, que todavía está en realización, y desarrolló además algo muy importante que fue la visión del Gran París en 2009, el Nuevo Moscú en 2012 y el Bruselas para 2040, para un periodo de 2012 y 2012. Desde 2014, la oficina de estudios para ahora que ganó ha ganado el Premio Internacional para la Ciencia, de la Ciencia en Roma. Y también está realizando un parque en Desa. En 2017, la oficina de estudio fue seleccionada en el Berlín Proyecto de Amberes. En 2015, fue seleccionada para el premio Mies van der Rohe Europeo por el Hostel in den Hoch en Rieren, en Bélgica. Paola Pino tiene muchas publicaciones muy interesantes y les aconsejo que lean encarecidamente. El territorio del urbanismo, muchas están traducidas, algunas traducidas al español. Territorialismo, Agua y Asfalto, el proyecto de la exotropía y uno muy interesante que se llama La Vía por todo eso, La Vía por la Ciudad por eso, publicado en Ginebra. Y nada más te dejo, Paola, para nosotros es una maravilla que estén aquí, sinceramente, especialmente para mí, que siempre te he seguido y creo que eres para mí un referente de eso del mundo.
Me gustaría hablar español, pero no es posible. So I will speak English. I think that you are quite tired after all this long day, and I'm a little bit tired. But I hope we can go through and maybe have a small discussion. I don't know exactly where I put my discourse on the upper floor or in the underground. I think what I would like is simply to speak of territory and of space. Space and territory. Space as a subject, or here we can say the territory as a plurality of subjects. Space as an agent and support. Space as capital, which I think when we speak about recycling as a previous presentation, we are in a way saying that space is a capital, is a resource, and sometimes I like to say that it's a renewable resource under certain conditions, of course. And I will use two cases. The first one is the case of a transnational context between Lille on the east, on the western side, Flanders and Wallonie, also two Belgian regions on the other side, three regions, two countries, two languages, common history, but a lot of differences, a lot of divisions. We started from the idea that we could find something in common in this territory. Maybe starting from the water question. Water is a very complex issue for contemporary territories, contemporary urban territories. And here we are inside a big basin at the Sked River. So it's just a piece of this bigger area. The part you see in the gray, inside the much vaster basin of the Sked River. And starting very simply, observing the different forms, the different water scales. There are corridors, canals. Canals that we can divide in two types of canals. The canals on which new big infrastructural projects are going to be realized, in particular the canal connecting the Paris region to the Northern Sea. So what is called the Canal Seine-Nord, that are being transformed, adapted to the passages of bigger boats. And there are slow canals that will remain out of this project. They are incredible, monumental spaces that have lost, in fact, their role. They will be there just as many beautiful spaces. That might play a different role in the future. So there are bigger lines that you see in this map, where you see also the national border between Belgium and France. Then another form, another water scale, is the capillary system. It's a system of small water courses that are really everywhere. And this is a way also to read the diffuse city that is typical of this part of Europe, mainly through this capillary system that is everywhere, it's close to every village. Every village has a water course, every piece of this diffuse city has some of these elements. And this is a very spongy, very diffuse system. And then there is a third water scale. Don't see, and this is the one you take. The fact that it is invisible to the people, to the inhabitants, makes this much difficult, more difficult theme to deal with, also because politicians are extremely sensitive. There are exchanges of water table. So the good water you need to drink, but you need also for your economy, the industrial also economy. And among the three regions, there are exchanges about this water table that is a less visible water scale. Nevertheless, it is fundamental to understand on the surface that that water table is there because it has to be protected, because it's very fragile. So in fact, it gives a lot of constraints, the fact that it is part of the water table. And we started with three hypotheses. The first one is not our hypothesis, but it's Paul Vidal de Lagrange, so the famous French geographer, that at the beginning of the 20th century, describing in his book, Tableau de la Géographie de la France, so the geography of France, and speaking about this part of France and Europe, he was using this words. There, in the water, there is the common trait. In the water, in this sharing, this water system, in its different dimensions, that is exactly what is to be in common, or what is in common, in this territory. The second hypothesis, this is our hypothesis, is that maybe these different waterscapes might be a new step. structure for the metropolis of the 21st century. I put into brackets weak structure, because of course it is not, especially the capillary system, it's not a very hard structure, for example, related to the mobility infrastructures, highways or bigger industrial platforms or ports. But it's a weaker structure, but I use weak structure in the sense of, for example, of the philosophy, weak of weakness, that Battimo, for example, discussed at the middle of the beginning of the 90s. I'm not using that in a postmodern sense. I think I really think in the belief in the strength of weakness, if you let me use this paradoxical way to discuss about weakness and strength. It's a weak structure, but it can play an important role in the future, and especially to give a structure to the contemporary scene. And the third hypothesis is that, nevertheless, frontiers exist. Although we know that when you cross the frontier between France and Belgium, there is no place of control, there is no checkpoint anymore. But nevertheless, this barrier, this changing of nation, is still something important. And this is especially important when you try to put maps together. There you understand that national borders are still fundamental. When we arrive to the point of sharing information about the territory, the borders are still there and are still making a difference. This is a collage of the two fundamental maps, less half of the 18th century. On one side, on the Belgian side, so on the right, you see the Ferraris map. It's fantastic map describing a territory that you can still recognize today, although it has changed dramatically, but at the same time you can still recognize the main structural elements of the territory. And on the other side, the series of the Cassini maps. So again, a description of France, fundamentally centered on describing a topography that you don't see. Because as you know, here we are very close to the flat land. But in fact, Cassini decides to dramatize topography that you don't see. And that's to me very interesting. Topography means understanding the water, of course. And then this map, it is making dramatic differences that are almost invisible, is for me extremely interesting, about the role of cartography. Cartography is not about a sort of abstract truth. Cartography is about interpretation, and Cassini decided to dramatize topography. For them, for De Cassini, topography was a fundamental object. So our three waterscapes, the corridors, the capillary system, and the water table, are starting point to reflect on this blue space. And we work in three ways, constructing an atlas, because of the question of cartography. The need of a common cartography was fundamental, and that was the first step was just to put together the different information and try to make them discuss and dialogue together. Then, because of these borders still there, we invented summer schools together, involving all the universities of the corner. So, French side, Walloon side, and Flemish side. So the different universities, the different school of architecture, of landscape architecture, working around there, which I think is also a very important point. If there are borders, I think we cannot just remain in a sort of closed environment where you work with a few people, you can You have to try to enlarge, to open, and there universities can play a major role, I think. So in this place where borders were important, we invented this strategy and we convinced the people working with us, I mean the youth metropolis, to start this series of summer schools, inviting the different universities and constructing moments of exchange exactly where in fact there was not an exchange. And finally, trying to get to some list or charter of actions that are to be voted now from the 157 mayors that are composing this area. Just today I received a message that the 157 mayors are still not completely convinced of the action. They fear the engagement they have to take. They want to be sure what kind of engagement they are taking with this charter of actions, but still we have some time to convince them. So the first summer school was about the corridors. We took this kind of reductionist approach. Of course, water is a very complex issue. It's too complex for many reasons. From the point of view of hydrology, but also from the point of view of the actors that are involved in the water management. There are so many, it's so difficult to put them all together. They speak different languages, they use different references. So it is extremely difficult to join, to put them around a table. And that's why we choose this kind of simplification. We were aware of that it was a simplification, but it was quite heavy. So the first corridor workshop, the corridors are this incredible mesh of rivers, canalized rivers, canals, sometimes following the main valleys. So they are rivers that have been canalized, sometimes going against topography. They are incredible incisions or invention of new topographic condition. When you superpose the canals to the ancient maps, you immediately understand that they are not following any rationality related to the territory. They are following other rationalities. They are incredible monuments also from this point of view. There are a lot of projects already ongoing on the major, especially on the big rivers, so the canal St. Lawrence, so this adaptation of a bundle of canals, not just one, but a series of canals, and other projects investing, for example, in the Skelt River or the Lys River. A lot of actors, as I was saying, one of the difficulties. So, a geography of power that is extremely complex. And this is, of course, again, part of the difficulty to treat the water problem in contemporary territory, but also of the need, in fact, to work with this geography of power. And the first elements of this atlas that we wanted to be cartographic, also iconographic, and I mean, as open as possible. Some exercises that we did that were a very interesting occasion to finally discuss concretely about this territory. There were a lot of fear. People were not really so open at the beginning to this, this type of work. So here we are along one of the big corridors that are being adapted today with the Sennor project. So, Lys, passing from France to Belgium. And the question when such a big project is arriving is that you have to conjugate the new role. So, a role related to logistics, to the passage of big boats, the needs of small logistic platforms, more or less everywhere. And this inside a landscape that is fundamentally, especially on the French side, very rural. And of course, conflicts and tension among the communities. On one side, the Walloon and the Flemish communities that are looking forward to this development, and they are already developing and making all the bridges higher in order to let the boats pass. On the other side, France, much more prudent, and people, communities, that really are not interested in this type of development. They want, on the contrary, to maintain this rural character, or to maintain biodiversity. They don't want to lose any quality of their landscape. So the conflict is clear, is evident. And of course, the theme is how can we work merging these different positions and imagine a hybrid landscape that can be at the same time logistic. Because we can't say that we want to reduce, for example, traffic by trucks, and then we don't want to adapt our canals. No, it's a kind of contradiction. So if you want to reduce the traffic on the European highways, probably you have to realize the canals. No. But resistances are quite strong, and so there's a confrontation on the two sides of the frontier in this case. And the exercise we tried with the students was to imagine this kind of hybridity, where at the same time you can maintain a continuity of public space, that you are not interrupted by the logistic platform, that you can maintain a continuity of biodiversity, and at the same time create this new logistic platform. And also recycling a lot of infrastructures that are already there. For example, old lines, railway lines, very abundant in this territory, that might connect activity areas with the new logistic platforms. Again, if we are imagining Europe with no cars and with no trucks, probably we have to work on the fluvial system, the canal system of logistics. This is, on the contrary, one of the slow canals that will not be interested by this highway of the water. This is a piece of the canal de Roubaix. So, if, for those that know Lille, Lille, Roubaix, Tourcoing, it's a very poor part of France, one of the most deprived areas in France. In fact, Canal de Roubaix is passing through a very degraded situation. And then, just passing the frontier, becomes extremely beautiful with a green landscape and changing its name, becomes Canal de l'Espierre. Rich people live close to it. So in a very, very small distance, you find a very contrasted situation. And there is the monument. In fact, partially, this is protected by UNESCO, partially. Because in fact, it's not clear what UNESCO is protecting. Sometimes they are speaking about just the trees, not really protecting all the canal, all the landscape. And it's fantastic machines that worked for some decades, also for so much time. And you see what the water is doing. The water is going up and going down. There's a system of locks. A lock every 100 meters. It's incredible. The effort that has been made to make water go from one point to another point, not following the slope, against the slope. So it's an incredible machine. Today, again, it's a heritage, it's a monument, for which we have to find the role that is not just to this, not just for the few boats passing and asking people to go there and open each lock one after the other in order to leave some small opening to pass from one side to the other, but especially in reconfiguring this contrasted social landscape that is around the canal. And especially what we discover, for example, in the Roubaix side, where a lot of abandoned industrial areas, today the new data center, the new place where you put those big spaces that are dedicated to store the information. So it needs also a lot of energy. They are reusing these spaces, which means that they are constructing new enclaves. And again, once again, after the Industrial Revolution, this will become a kind of closed, fenced part of the city. So starting from the idea of using the canal to structure these issues, we imagine to introduce permeability in the condition. But the small images on the top does say that there are different themes along that can be really the starting point for the qualification of this territory. Another slow canal is what we missed, the canal Latong Hat, very slow, but with the possibility of multifunctionality along this, this canal. If we look at all the services, collective public equipment that are along the water, there are so many, because along the water there are the villages also. And then we can imagine that maybe water, although it's slow, can play a role in connecting all this support. And then we can imagine new, small public spaces. These are quite poor areas. We are in the Walloon side. Quite poor areas with some abandoned industries, very small villages, a lot of rurality, but all these equipment. And you can imagine maybe to have small public floating libraries using the boats or restructuring some small public spaces in order to organize markets. You can really again imagine to rethink completely the quality of these spaces starting from this new relation with the canal that is already there, that is already a fantastic space. And you just need a small project, small touch to make it a little bit more readable, more usable. And of course, we reflect on the bigger scale of all the structures and how can we imagine to really abstract the continuity. What is interesting is that exactly the point that is that the main valleys that are southwest, northeast oriented, so the water is flowing towards the north. But then we have the canals, the artificial canals that are really crossing and they go through and against the slope. So it's a reading of the territory that is not natural. It's completely artificial and it's completely interesting for this plan. And then at the end of this first workshop, we drove on the floor. We were in the School of Architecture of Tournai, and all the school now is in another beautiful building, but at the moment it was sitting in all the strange Harry Potter type of school. And there was this fantastic wooden floor, and we designed this first idea of this infrastructure and structure together with the existing parts that are connected by our new type of park. The second workshop is about the capillary system, and we understood very soon that the main problems in terms of flooding risk was in the capillary system and not in the big system of the rivers. There was also the main problem of the quality of the water in relation with the pollution created by agriculture. And of course, we think that the capillary system could really be a device to construct a continuity of public spaces inside dispersed and fragmented territory. We chose three small water basins in the three different regions. Each time we had to represent, of course, the three regions. Again, we met a lot of actors on site. Really with a lot of work by bike and walking. And we started to produce postcards just to give an image to reinforce the imagery related to these spaces. That in fact they are really part of the interior image of this territory. And then I did that was more or less from this region and then we go to the east. René Magritte painted in 1933 this fantastic painting. And the title is The Human Condition. I think that's exactly the point. It's this landscape, the capillary landscape, that is always the lowest point in the territory, the wetter area, where you can only have some animals, pastures, nothing more. You can been to the street to wait. And it's always at the on your from your window, normally in this diffuse city, you always have this landscape. So it's your human condition, where you are, where you inhabit the territory. And of course there is the tricky quality of the painting being superposed to the painting. And then the question of Magritte is, of course, what is behind? Is there continuity? Is really what is represented? Or is something that is hidden? And of course we are left with this question, which is part, I think, of the problem of our human condition. And following the capillaire, we could go into the metropolitan area of Lille. In this case, the capillary system becomes a sort of central park, if you can use this easy image, to develop scenarios for a metropolitan area that is nevertheless growing, is growing, although still a little bit too poor, but is growing. And trying to avoid simplification, for example, the idea of the central park. So you densify just on the border, and those that are today inside the flooded area, you let them go. And then we listen to the mayors of the villages inside the flooded area say, but why we should be sacrificed to the metropolis? And I agree with them, why then should the villages inside the flooded area to be the victim of the growth of the metropolis? Why don't we imagine a more horizontal growth in which we can protect also the villages that are there, and maybe the metropolis can find a more integrated relation with the flooding risk in terms of also of landscapes that are infiltrating into the denser part. And then we can imagine the different scales to organize also the process of growth in terms of intensification, small densifications, and also connected resolving also the problem of the water management. In Flanders is a highly artificial ground, to say 100% artificial ground, extremely charged of infrastructure. This development, in fact, is disappearing, is going in the different opposite direction from where it should go, because it's been completely manipulated, completely transformed. And of course, here we have the problems of redesign the waterbed and slow down the water because of the impermeable surfaces. Today, this morning, someone was talking about that. So the question is, of course, to maintain the water, to use the water, instead of immediately sending it somewhere else where it will create other problems. And then using also the movement water inside industrial areas and to depurate, to filtrate, etc., and to infiltrate the water. In the Walloon part, again, it's another of the capillary, the whole state of the art of the capillary system. Here there's a problem in this image, but okay, this was a taxonomy of all the small capillaries that are the affluent of the whole typologies of small water courses that are more related to the living part or more related to agriculture or more related to industries. And also you see that there are mayors that are understanding that the metropolization is going on. Brussels becoming more attractive, we are not so far. And in fact, the new pressure, even in these areas that have been forgotten for 40 years after the decline of the industries, even in these areas, the pressure of urbanization is arriving. So you have mayors that imagine to put new neighborhoods into the flooded areas. So they are free, they are flat, so you put the new neighborhood there. And then, of course, rethinking this type of projects. Imagining, of course, to maintain and to use the capillary areas just really as a spine, as a structure for the necessary to be densification of these areas. And this picture started to connect the corridors together with the capillary system. As you are understanding this, the park is just a part of this, this work, but the park is important because it's generating a new image. So it's a park of connections. It's just connecting. It's just lines. Lines with a certain thickness, and it is connecting the existing parks, it's connecting all the cities, the centers, the villages, it's connecting all the stations. So it's giving an accessibility to all the territory that is totally alternative to the actual way in which you use the territory. The third workshop on the water table was also very interesting. And for me it's interesting also because it's obliging us, so architects and urbanists, to draw differently. So we cannot just remain on our beautiful section where there is a white part underground. The city, the contemporary city, has to be understood also through sections that are including geology, including soil qualities, including the water table. And the problems related to that, you see the form of the city, the type of very, very dispersed type of city. And then you see the different types of water tables. There is a water table that was mainly used during the industrial period, and this today is not, it was very polluted, but today it's not very much used anymore. There is the water table in the Lille area that is the one that is crucial for the economic and for the life of all the three regions, not just for Lille. And then there is the sand water table in the Flemish style, which is totally unusual. So practically, Flanders has no water table. That's why Flanders has a very big problem with water for the future. And Flanders being economically very powerful, the problem of water is becoming a true handicap for its economy. The last studies say that 1 out of 7 jobs is directly related to the availability of water, for example. And in the Lille area, so there are these areas, there are already projects and parks on the blue, the dark blue part. So, in fact, the part is highly protected. But the problem is that the protection should be much larger than just the narrow part that has been already imagined as a park. So the problem is not the highly protected area. The problem is the rest. How are we going to protect? Of course, you cannot imagine state or the public power buy 1,000 hectares to protect the water table. So it's a question of rules, of regulations. It's a question of a project that has to be realized in a very decentralized way, not as a big project, but on the contrary, it's a project made by each individual. And so different strategies, for, of course, you can infiltrate polluted water, so when you have activity areas, you have to consider them as being completely impermeable. You should not let any drop infiltrate there. And the water has to be brought in specifically, see where it can be depurated and finally can be infiltrated. Or when it's agriculture, you have to be sure that there are areas for the depuration of the water and so on. So you understand the deviation between the surface and the underground is very strict, but we are not used to make of this situation a project. So my point is we have to start to transform in design occasions all these new conditions. This is a very nice case that I especially like, but I like this because it's being considered impossible. So you have the border in yellow, and you have on one side, the French side, mainly abandoned industrial fish. Then on the other side, on the southern part, you have the Wallonie side, you have industrial areas that are not of very high quality, but they exist. And then on the northern side, Flanders, you have entrepreneurs that have no areas anymore. So, in my opinion, a transnational project should be able to put together the French entrepreneurs, the fish in France, the low quality areas in Wallonie, knowing that in fact they share the common water table. When I presented this project, people tell me, ah, oh, that's utopia. No, that's not utopia, that's a political thinking. This should be possible. They are close, they have the same infrastructure, they are sharing the same water table. On one side, you have a poor population living together with a polluted industrial area, so there's also a problem with health, etc. And on the other side, you have the rich French entrepreneurs looking for, searching for ground. So it seems evident, but this is not all. In the Flemish side, not only they don't have any more space, and they don't have the water table, so they have to collect each drop. For them, it's fundamental to reuse, to recycle every single drop arriving on the land. So everywhere, you should imagine that this water is collected and reused for different purposes. Again, a very highly decentralized type of project. We insist on this point because many of the problems we have in the contemporary city have this nature of not, they are not solved by big centralized infrastructure. They will be solved only through decentralized, dispersed interventions. This type of representation, I'm proud of it, is a collage of different scales trying to connect a reinterpretation of the water table discussed with the hydraulic engineers and geologists, a collage of images, and then this kind of panorama, and we can represent the different interventions, knowing that the main point for us is this. The surface water table is the only resource for Flanders. So to feed the surface water table that normally is not even considered as an important part of the problem. Why on the Walloon side, where there are big quarries and the cathedral, the magnificent cathedral of Tournai, has been taken out of the quarry and transformed into a cathedral, the water. Some of them are already abandoned, one are already transformed in lakes. But you can imagine a new cycle, new energetic cycles producing hydropower thanks to the water, thanks to the big basins that have been created. So the idea of productivity not being something of the past and then we have only leisure, no, maybe we can also work on producing something different from the past, for example, energy. So, we have a series of themes, space of continuities, composite of coexistence, so hybrid character, ecological device, of course, and solidarity, upstream, downstream. And the four themes are in a way connected by this new image that is a park. A park, as you see there, made of 300 kilometers of corpus. The main capillary system is 2,300 meters. All the capillary system is 5,440 meters long, and if you put all together, you have 5,000 kilometers of new connectivity. Just imagine to have a path along this route. So, in that sense, I think that to imagine this as a weak, but nevertheless, structure for the contemporary city is something realistic and is not impossible, not from a financial point of view, because a big part of the park is already there, and the big advantage is that it's able to create an image of this territory that has never been seen like that. And I'm speaking about images. And here I want to quote André Coco, his famous article, The Territory of Principalities. He said, the main point is the projection de toute nature s'attache à lui, qui le transforme en un sujet. So the fact of becoming a subject is also related to the number of projections, so the different images that we reverse on the territory itself and enrich the territory, becoming a true subject. My second case is a different one. This is related to the exercise I made with students last year at the University of Virginia, so the Thomas Jefferson University. The title, The Mystery of American Reality, is a quotation from Jean Baudrillard, Amérique. Baudrillard compares two attitudes, the European, utopian, messianic attitude, opposed, not compared, opposed to what he describes as radical empiricism of the United States. Two different attitudes. There is no utopia in the United States, but there is a radicality of the experience. That for us, sometimes we read it as utopian. Imagine the communities in the United States, very radical lifestyles. So for him, this is not utopia. Utopia is typically European product. For him, that is radical empiricism. And this radical empiricism is what makes the United States so difficult to understand. So that's why it's a mystery. Mystery for America. And to touch this mystery, there was something I was still curious after having taught the GSD. So, was this bigger, let me say, island of Appalachia? This is an island because it's, you can recognize it. It's different from the rest. And in the short period I spent there, because I compacted the semester in 1 month, I could not stay longer. I could only imagine to go towards research on Appalachia. Appalachia is a 13th state, very long mountain chain, nevertheless inhabited by 25 million of people. It is a poor region where you have different images being confronted, the image of mines fundamentally, or the low density settlement, but also confronted with some metropolitan areas. So, the question is also here a little bit methodological. So how do you address, or can we address, as architects and urbanists, such an object? 25 million, big scale, not so much time, not so many information. Of course, there is a big literature about Appalachia, but almost nothing about the space of Appalachia. It is here that I revendicate the capacity of working, understanding, interpreting, designing space. And if I can say something to the former UNHABITANT director, there is not enough space in the UNHABITANT. There is a lot of other things. Economy, sociology, geography, etc. Space, not really. On the contrary, I think that space is really an entry. It is a way to understand things. That is adding something to other more traditional way of looking at the territory. So the challenge here is using our instruments to address such big scale objects and try to add something different from what an existing imposing literature on Appalachia is already saying. So we start from physical elements. So the physiography, because a palazzo is mainly a physical object, like an island, that you can really recognize among the rest. So you understand there are different parts in a palazzo. And then we take the central part of a palazzo. Here is Washington. And we consider this like a big transect. We make a section from the ocean to the internal part, and this is a palazzo as an exception. And this is already interesting because of the traditional representation. For example, if I think to Bento Mekai representations, also making a section transversal to the ocean, to the coast, always stopping on the ridge of a palazzo. So a palazzo was always considered like the margin, the conclusion of a system. The coastal system, the plain, and then up to the mountain where you stop. But it's clear that this island is in between somehow. It's not isolated, it's not the conclusion, it's just in between space. It is an in-between space that maybe can profit much more than what is today is the case of this in-between condition between the richer part of the coast, but also the new megalopolis on the west. In fact, it's in-between megalopolis, and it is this kind of island. When I use the term island, it's also to underline the fact that in megalopolis, this is a void. It's like a big void inside megalopolis. When we think to the megalopolitan development, we have to start to read the voids inside megalopolis. Gottman, when defining the eastern side of the United States as megalopolis, was insisting on this kind of integration continuity. Urban continuity created by megalopolis. Today, this is a fact, and we are not coming back on this interpretation, but what I think is important is to read what the empty part of, empty in the sense of means, in the sense of economy, problematic areas that opens up inside megalopolis. When you make the sections at the different part of the chain, you understand very well this being in between two areas and being an exception inside this. So first the kind of cartographic exercise of physical features, but then outside. So again, we went through this section, this transect, and we were following something that I will tell you immediately. But first, let's give a look to this void in megalopolis. This is a city. It's a very small high street. And my point is, first of all, is this city? I was arguing with the students, this is not a city. This is a county. It's a county. A lot of people are living into lots of this kind of caravans. And even when the house seems just put very light, the fact that there is not the infrastructure we think is associated to being a city. And we were following an author, this man. He was a writer. He committed suicide when he was very early, 27. And he wrote just one book about this country. And then we went to his city and we followed his trajectory, being from that city and then being also at the University of Virginia. And by doing this, we were discussing and exchanging with people in the interviews, collecting data, data that are showing that the economy is more and more related to services. I will tell you later why. And showing some possible geographies of mobilities. So this is Greece, DJ Pankey. He describes in this small book the places where he was from. And here we see also the main landscape, the landscape in the mines, and the typical situation. And then we made maps of his descriptions. So here I was inspired by a literary critical, Franco Moretti, that described the European novel through mappings. And he discovered the power of mapping literature, because he said that when you make the maps of what an author of, for example, the English novel of the 19th century, you discover things that you have not understood without the map. Of course, we know that. So we mapped also his places. For example, there's a river, and then there's a river that has disappeared, this river. And there is a very beautiful passage of Arcade in which he said, a long time from me, from his tools, the Thames, the river Thames flowed here. I can almost feel the cold waters and the tickling of the trilobites made when they crawled. All the water from the old mountains flowed west, but the land lifted. They have only the bottoms and stone animals I collect. So there is this geographical and also the stratification of the territory. It is immediately clarified by the answer. And now, of course, this is a very fertile area, cultivated, very beautiful landscape. And you can connect very rapidly the underground with the actual situation. And also, we understood that this plateau, that is what is called as a plateau, in fact, it's not flat, it's just a incredible rugosity of the land, which constructs specific spatial conditions for the settlement. All the people we discussed with, they have no hope. No one told us, I think that the future will be good. Everybody was telling us, there is no hope in this region, and we want to go away as soon as possible. But not everybody cannot go away. And there are different settlement types, cities, small villages. There are some settlements that are specifically related to the mines. And there are new inhabitants, like this man, that are coming there they retire, and they decide to go and live in some of these areas because they are less expensive than living in Washington. So if you have not so high revenue as an older person, you can go there, you can use this beautiful landscape, and you can tell in this here, no, where you have a big amount of elderly people arriving here. And why is going there? Not just because life is less expensive, but also because there are hospitals. So in fact, because the care is nevertheless quite good. And then he accepted to be a voluntary in the Appalachian Trail, and that's something interesting, because the voice of the Americans are also places for this type of choices. And then we continue with the parents' test of exploitation. So the main image of Appalachia is an image of exploitation. This is a territory that has been always, at least from the Europeans, always exploited. That's the main reason why it is what is today. So mines, coals, coke, gas, everything. This palate test of exploitation means to understand the rationality of the techniques, of the way to construct a space of exploitation, but also to understand how people inhabit the space of exploitation, because there are people living there, and 25 million, maybe we are talking about, although dispersed. So an amount, incredible amount of railroads that were only dedicated to coal, so they are not for passengers, and today are really abandoned. And there are different types of mining. So this picture is very emblematic. So in fact, in the different red rows. So the rows is the underground mining. And then there is another row, so it's pretty dark. These are the surface mining. The surface mining consists in making an explosion. So it's called top mountain removal. So there's an explosion, the top of the mountain is exploded. So you lose the top of the mountain. The coal that is very precious, very high quality coal that is completely, totally exported, mainly in China. So this coal is taken out of the rocks and the rest is put in the red part, for example here. These are the valleys. So imagine you have our rugosity, you make explode the top of the mountain, and then you take out the coal, and the rest, you just fill the valleys. So, in a very short period, you can completely destroy the actual landscape. So there are, of course, movements, ecological activists fighting against this type of work that has been started 15 years ago, but is already immense, the surface that has been modified by this technique. And of course it is a technique that doesn't use a lot of people, so about the job question. They don't need it, they just need a lot of explosion. So, in fact, you are not generating any job here, you are just destroying your country. And, let me go a bit quicker, so, how were these people living? And here we describe, that's why I insist on the fact that we try to describe space, something that has not been seen very frequently. Although, especially in literature, you can find some description of it. So there are these small valleys, so in this city of these small valleys, were leading to the entry of the mine. Along these valleys, there were houses. So here is where people are living, not were living. They are living along these small valleys into the lower part, leading to the starting point of the mine. And then you have the houses, one after the other, along. You have to imagine yourself living there, completely disconnected from everything. I think this is a pattern. I think it's a pattern that has not been seen very frequently, but this is a pattern of a setting in the United States of America. And then you understand this collective relation between the topographic surface and the act of inhabiting. So then you live into the trench and the creux, and you live really in the lower, in the bottom. And all the scholars say that this, in a way, the way to conclude that there is no territory without the imagining of this territory. People are living there, are developing their images in this territory. So we decided to displace a little bit after this description of the palimpsest of exploitation about the resources. They are, of course, the traditional resources are those that are exploited, so mines, coal, etc. But in fact, there are other resources. There are timber, for example. There are water, waterways. And in principle, there is also agriculture. That's also interesting. Economists writing about, there's an interesting book about the construction of a dependency, so the path of dependency, by destroying the agriculture of Appalachia. So at the moment of the boom of the mining, Appalachia was autosufficient in terms of agricultural production. But it was made express to destroy the agriculture of Appalachia in order to construct a dependency of Appalachia on other exterior, external market. So, this kind of more fertile areas, this is the Shenandoah Valley, it's full of big parking areas. They are spaces that are today partially conservated, but, and of course there are specific settlement patterns there, but in fact the part that is cultivated is the floodplain, pasture, animals. It's not really an interesting type of production, but the very fertile parts are not over the plain, are the slopes. So where the gray, the darker gray, is located. But of course, for the machine, for an industrial agriculture, it's more difficult to cultivate the most fertile land. So the result is that the fertile lands are not cultivated, and what is more or less cultivated, but mainly, as I said, with animals, is the flood. So it is a contradiction that can understand and explain the question of dependency that has been created. Then we went back to a bigger scale, and here you understand the idea of the island. So you see very well Appalachia, and you see what is around Appalachia, and the connectivity. Appalachia is also the place where Alberto Mackay created in the 20s and the 30s a very important Appalachian trail. This is an hypothesis which I have been fighting. So Bento Mackay hypothesis is that the Appalachian trail will reverse the economy of this marginal area. He was imagining that the trail would have be the infrastructure, the main infrastructure, to maintain the resources extracted in this territory, mainly inside the territory, reversing the flow of the resources going towards the coast, to the harbor, to the exportation, export, etc. Of course, Bento Mackay was wrong. It was wrong. The Appalachian Trail has been realized. It's a trail, it's a nice touristic attraction, but has not been able to reverse economically the shift in demographics is speaking about the fact that the areas that are closer to the main metropolitan areas are growing, while the areas that are more disconnected are losing population. This is a very interesting image. Politics and geology. So in red, Trump fans, and in blue, Democrats. It's interesting because the Democrats, as you know, the northern part of New York, Boston, you know, there is a strong legacy, and there is also an interesting Black Belt, that is the old slavery area that is still Democrat. But what is impressive, of course, is the homogeneity of Appalachia being voting and constructing a direct relation with Donald Trump. Donald Trump, during the campaign, was every evening on the television promising that the mines will be reopened for the people of Appalachia. And this very embarrassing figure about the opioid crisis. So in fact the population of Appalachia is completely destroyed from a healthy point of view, as the population is completely destroyed. And you see also the tendency from 1999 to today becoming worse. That is an abuse of medicaments and drugs that is out of control. Everybody in the interviews was telling us that it was the main problem. Because they were working in the mines, and then of course it was causing a lot of problems, or because they are simply there without any job. So for one of the different reasons, but there is a consumption, very heavy consumption of drugs in Appalachia. Okay, so now I want to show you a small video, if you still have a bit of passion. Because what we tried after this exercise was to propose, we could not develop scenarios for Appalachia, but we could maybe indicate some possible trajectories. for the future of agricultural outreach. The first one is proposing to work together with the machine of extraction. The first scenario is saying we accept the fact this, and I think also for the island research, this is something important. Very often islands are just places to be. So the first scenario is considered the machine of extraction, and imagining that there is a possibility to use it also for different purposes, to create something positive for this population, accepting the rationality of the machine, but trying to force it in certain directions. The second scenario is reflecting on the possibility for Appalachia to be completely disconnected and autonomous. In fact, that is the idea that we need today more and more spaces that are completely disconnected, where those that fear catastrophes, that fear the future, can find a refuge. So there is the idea of territories that can be a refuge. Again, I think for in that sense, I think islands are very close to this situation. So the refuge. The third scenario is making the hypothesis that the presence of the metropolitan areas with the differences that they are starting to generate inside Appalachia, so for example, the more population close to the metropolitan area and losing population when you are more distant, that this can be a lever for emancipation of this territory, in which you have to sacrifice something. You have to sacrifice the unified image of Appalachia as one. And the strong hypothesis to say that Appalachia today is not homogeneous, it's not one, it's made and took, of course, a Pirandello title, is 100,000. That's Appalachia today, a variety of situations. Okay, if we, someone can help me.
Extrapolating existing regional trends, this scenario is premised on an acceptance of Appalachia's national role as a territory of resource extraction and energy production. In this future, regulatory, technological, and economic conditions align with the drive of natural gas. Development of automated extraction techniques provides access to previously unreachable coal seams, and the region continues to be a center of chemical production and distribution. Appalachia cements itself as a region that helps determine the energy economy of the United States and large portions of the world. With the advent of increasingly inexpensive alternative and renewable energy sources, the continued economic viability of coal and gas depends on keeping extraction and transportation costs low. In this scenario, automated processes such as GPS-guided heavy machinery and remotely operated pipeline networks are deployed throughout the region. Coal and gas output increases, but employment by those industries continues to fall, exacerbating vicious socioeconomic cycles. The population of Appalachia decreases and ages as new generations seek opportunity elsewhere. Those who stay are exposed to the public health dangers of extraction byproducts and remain continually reliant on social assistance of various kinds. In this vision, the Appalachian region becomes, in essence, a landscape given over entirely to extraction, an increasingly uninhabitable territory dominated by the value systems and operational logistics of resource exploitation. The effects on the landscape are dramatic. Widespread mountaintop removal flattens the region's topographic variation and the social and biological diversity it engenders. Streams are redirected to carry the byproducts of extraction into the Atlantic and Mississippi watersheds. Chemical plants continue to spread along major waterways, and logging intensifies. An urban vision for this scenario depends on leveraging, hijacking, or otherwise working with the economics, politics, and spatial logistics of extraction. This might include the development of effective post-extraction landscape remediation techniques, the productive reuse of disturbed sites, and finding ways to invite the public to engage with the spectacle of extraction processes and the landscape they produce.
This scenario imagines a post-extraction future for Appalachia, building upon the territory's potential for biodiversity and the informal economies that already play a significant role in the region. It imagines a future in which coal continues its decline and in which the natural gas industry faces stiff competition from the increasingly widespread availability of inexpensive renewable energy sources. In the face of this dramatic economic shift, the region turns inward towards a state of self-sufficiency. Rather than being seen primarily as a resource to be exploited for the benefit of the rest of the country, the region becomes a testing ground for experiments in the radical coexistence of people, non-human life, and the land. With the decline of the fossil fuel industry, the redistribution of the Appalachian population from small rural areas to the cities at the edge of the region accelerates, and the shrinking industrial tax base necessitates a careful reallocation of state resources. Selective investment focuses on local roads and repurposed rail networks, leaving interstate highways, hydraulic infrastructure, and industrial sites to be reclaimed by natural ecological processes and the logics of non-human species. The remaining rural population continues its cultivation of informal and marginal economies, making their livings through barter, local currencies, and community-based services, including sowing, woodcutting, and homestead farming. They are joined by new populations from elsewhere in the country, who are drawn to the region precisely because it offers the chance to articulate new ways of living on the land. Homesteaders are joined by survivalists, doomsday preppers, coastal residents displaced by climate change, and rural entrepreneurs. The holler is reestablished as the basic unit of rural settlement, and a residential economy based on small-scale agriculture, outdoor recreation and ecotourism, and alternative energy emerges. In this scenario, the designer's role focuses on new choreographies of human and non-human actors in a landscape that is not merely a recovery of an idealized past, but the establishment of a radically different future. Can former mountaintop removal sites be repurposed for renewable energy production or terraced agricultural plots? Can abandoned coal camps be resettled and served by new networks of passenger rail? Can new institutions, new infrastructures, and new practices of cultivation and maintenance establish a new form of rural American life?
Identifying a ecological parameters, including settlement patterns, geospatial characteristics, habitat biodiversity, economic networks, and public health outcomes. In this possible future, the increasing diversity of conditions leads to a fracturing of the singular identity of the region, with subregions instead associating themselves with the territories that border Appalachia or taking on strong identities of their own based on intrinsic characteristics or potentials. Subregions associated with major metro areas, including the three mega regions that border Appalachia to the east, south, and northwest, help establish a new pattern of American metropolitan existence, characterized not by a center and periphery relationship, but rather by an isotropic urbanity in which access to infrastructure and services is distributed widely across the territory. Interior subregions may remain independent, pursuing an autarchical future as in the previous scenario, or transferring themselves into large-scale reserves of largely uninhabited open land. In this scenario, there is, by definition, no single project, no unified urban vision for the region as a whole. Rather, this scenario envisions a series of projects in which urbanists and designers help identify and cultivate the characteristics that distinguish the subregions. Each region then becomes a territory with its own set of possible features to be explored and pursued independently.
Okay, I want to conclude with, with this quotation of the last article, the last essay that Bernardo Secchi wrote. The metaphysical and psychological commitment of modern Western urbanism is towards conceiving the project of the city and the territory as being part of a vast, vaster biopolitical action. That's why I think that this reflection, and also reflection of the islands that you are doing, is in fact dealing with the space. Space and territory, and space as a way to reconstruct the possible emancipation. And I distinguish these three main themes. The first, the question of biopower, so the power on life that we know from the modern version of this power, interested to give us security, to make discipline for us, etc. That's what we said. Today, probably, we have to reformulate this idea of biopolitics and of biopower. The second is the deep ecology. The second scenario you have heard that is really the idea of a new choreography of coexistences, while the first scenario was mainly working on the idea of a spectacle of extraction. And finally, the emancipation of the subject, because the third scenario is dealing with normality. People that just want to be normal, that they want to be different, although maybe mythically different, you know, Appalachian. They want to be normal, they just want to have what the other people have. So the emancipation of the subject of every single individual. I think that these three levels are to be considered, for example, in a research on Appalachian.